Hi, I'm James Robinson, and this is my stock pick of the week. This is part two in my five-part series on Graham Holdham Company, symbol GHC. So in this talk, we're going to talk about the operations of GHC. And the operations of GHC are not as easy to analyze as with most companies, because Graham Holdham Company isn't a company. It's a holding company. It's a conglomerate. It's a combination of a whole bunch of companies, and each of those companies has their own idiosyncrasies. It has their own things that they do well and things that they do poorly. Oftentimes when I look at a company, I'm looking for, as we talk about those sort of five taxes and how a company does in terms of managing its plants and equipment versus its cost, versus its research and development, its inventory. And what happens with a conglomerate is that the company's individual operating entities will have very, very different characteristics. And each of those companies independently might have really, really good characteristics. But when they're all blended together, the hodgepodge maybe isn't quite so exciting. And that's when you look at GHC, you'll see it that I typically rank companies on a scale of 1 to 4 in 29 categories. And 10 of those categories are operations. Typically, when I suggest you buy a company, when you look at the company's operations, the aggregate score of those operations is going to be above 3. And that's because I've looked specifically at the operations of those companies, and I rule out so many companies that don't do a great job in operations. But when you've got a conglomerate, and on the one hand, it's a restaurant company, on the other hand, it's Kaplan, which is Clyde Restaurants, and another hand, it's Kaplan, which is an education industry, and another one is Hoover Treated Wood Products. Well, those companies have such different fundamentals in the way that they operate. They have different gross margins. They have different costs for general administrative and sales costs, and different costs and different amounts of inventory that they require. When you have a bunch of different companies, they tends to be a regression to the mean, and a regression to the mean tends to be less exciting. So I have looked closely at this company's numbers, and I believe this company is a strong company. I believe that independently, these companies are all probably pretty well in the category, in the range that I would like, but when you combine them all together, they're not as attractive. So that's one of the reasons, as you go through this analysis of the company's operations, you're going to see that it's not as exciting as many of the companies I suggest you should buy. And that's my understanding and my explanation of why that is. The place that I always start my analysis of a company is in looking at the operations and in looking at the gross margins for a company. So gross margins is really the relationship between the gross revenue and the costs of goods sold. And I like to see as high a gross margin as possible for the simple reason that I think that demonstrates that our company has pricing power. I think that it demonstrates the company is probably a consumer monopoly. It shows that the company has an ability to withstand changes in the marketplace and still be profitable. So there's lots of reasons why I really like gross margin. When you look at gross margins for this company, you see that the gross margins were pretty good until about 2013, and then they dropped off the table and they went to zero. Well, no company can have gross margins of zero, because that would mean that the cost of goods sold equal the cost of the total revenue. And that's not what's happened here. What's happened here is that in 2013, this company stopped being predominantly a manufacturer and started thinking of themselves as predominantly a service provider. And as a result, they went from using cost of goods sold as a measure to cost of services. And so you can look at the cost of services in relation to profits, and I could have made that change, but I thought it was more interesting to talk about what happened and why it happened and use this as an excuse to illustrate it. This company's primary driver of revenue for a long, long time was that newspaper, the Washington Post. They no longer have the Washington Post, and now they've stopped being a company with a primary industry driving their business, and they've switched to being a conglomerate of a whole bunch of little businesses that drive the revenues. And we're going to look closely at a bunch of things here. The gross margins for this company aren't as important because there's a bunch of other things going on that we're going to talk about. But I wanted to point out to you what happened here and why it happened. I wanted you to point out that I did look at cost of goods, the cost of services delivered. Obviously, they're fine. They're not spectacular. They're not bad. They're pretty average. But I wanted you to understand what was going on there. Here you look at earnings per share, and as well as earnings themselves. You can see that earnings for this company have been relatively flat really for 20 years. I believe that number's gonna start changing, which is why I'm suggesting you buy it. By the way, we're also buying the company at 7x earnings. So even if they stay exactly where they are, I think we're gonna do very, very well as investors. But I think this number's gonna change. When you look at earnings per share diluted, again, what you see is that while the earnings have been pretty flat, the earnings per share have actually done pretty well. That's because the company has been buying back some stock. We'll talk about that when we talk about wealth creation for the company. But one of the things to note here is that with the exception of 2016, this company's always been profitable. They just keep adding money into the deal. They don't pay a tremendous amount of money in dividends, but what they are trying to do is reinvest the money. And I believe that that reinvestment of the money is starting to work well. And so again, there's this giant bump in 2014. I believe that that's the result of the sale of the newspaper, which generated a profit that year. But long story short, the earnings for this company are pretty stable. The earnings per share for the company have been growing pretty well, especially since 2016, where they've gone up dramatically. 2020 will have been a bit of a down year due to COVID. They have some operations which did poorly. Clyde's Restaurant, as you can imagine, got hammered. Kaplan Education did poorly, especially those divisions that required sort of in-house training versus online training. But the earnings per share aren't a problem for this company. They're not going up, they're not on a rocket ship to the moon, but when you're buying a company at 7x earnings, they don't have to be. One of the reasons that I'm willing to overlook the cost of goods sold issue with this company and sort of the amalgamation of all of these companies sort of regressing to the mean in terms of the company's operations is you boil down the total revenues and the net earnings as a percentage of revenue. And you say, okay, in the last 4 years, this company's been in the top 25% of companies in terms of converting revenue into net earnings. So that's money that actually makes it to the bottom line. And while I love to see gross margins, it's not as important to me to see great margins if I see that this company is taking all of the money that they make and doing a great job of converting that to money at the bottom line. And that's what you've seen for the last 3 or 4 years here. So if this company is able to grow its revenues over time, we'll do a great job of converting those revenues, we believe, to the bottom line. And that'll make this company a very solid company, which is one of the reasons why I'm willing to overlook the whole fact that I'm not as excited about the aggregate gross margins for the company. The other thing to see here is total revenues have been pretty flat since 2013, but they have started to tick up in the last few years. Obviously, 2020 was a bad year due to COVID, but they have been starting to pick up. And as those have been starting to pick up, I think you're going to see profits pick up. One of the things that's happening is this company continues to buy small new companies. And typically when you buy a company, there are some costs associated with integrating that company into the business. There's some acquisition costs, and some of those things sort of will, in the short term, there's also goodwill that you have to burn off. And so some of those things will sort of retard the earnings, but not necessarily the cash flows in the first year or two of acquisition. But over time, those acquisitions that you make should be cumulative and compounding in terms of the benefit of the company. So while net earnings have been pretty flat since 2013, they have been gradually increasing, and the profits, I think, are gonna follow suit. And you know, a lot of the things that are happening here with this company, I should point out, are sort of projections, things that I see happening. I kind of feel like this company is stable. I like their philosophy and why they're buying companies and what they're trying to buy. I think they're a value company. I think they're trying to be a baby Berkshire. And I think that if you look back at Berkshire, you're not gonna see that the day Warren Buffett bought Berkshire Hathaway, it took off. It took a little time. It had to build sort of a critical mass. And that's kind of what I think is happening here. Another thing that really really does excite me about this company is how it handles these five taxes. When I look at a company, obviously you get your total revenue, then you have to subtract from that the costs of the goods that it takes to make your revenue, so cost of goods sold, or in this case, cost of services delivered. And then you're left with operating income. And from that operating income, you have to pay a bunch of business costs, things like plants and equipment, things like research and development, things like inventory and selling and general administrative. And the thing that makes a management good and the thing that I really value and look at with operations is how well a company does on handling those kind of items. And what you can see here is that selling and general administrative has been plummeting since 2011, 2010 maybe. It's even done a very good job since 2013 when they sold the Washington Post. So they're buying companies that are not highly intensive in terms of management, general administrative, or in terms of sales costs, And they've gone from outside of the top 25% of companies in selling and general administrative to just outside the top 10% of companies. So this is part of what I talked about. I'm happy with the management of the decisions they're making. This is in the aggregate. And so I'm pretty excited about this. And these are the kinds of things that make me excited about this company. The same thing is true to a similar degree with plants and equipment. Since 2013, since really 2010, those numbers have dropped pretty much every year. Last year in 2020, they went up again. It's plants and equipment in relation to assets. So I think there would be some changes there due to COVID that made it pop up in the last year. But generally speaking, this company's in the top 25% in terms of the plants and equipment that they need to utilize to make money. And that's a really positive sign. The next two taxes that I look at is inventory. The problem with inventory as a business is that it typically costs a lot of money to make your product. And if you have it in inventory, that's money that's tied up not productively. A second thing that happens with inventory is that your products tend to get stale and wear out. So example, the worst example is obviously a fruit stand, right? A fruit stand that has a lot of money tied up in inventory is in trouble because one day there's not gonna be an ability to sell it, and the fruit all goes bad, and now that inventory is lost. Apple computers, you know, when they have if they had a ton of inventory and they came up with a new computer, well, the old computer is instantaneously obsolete, and that inventory becomes stale. So we don't like to see companies with a lot of inventory, generally speaking. This company has seen its inventories increase since 2013, but that makes sense because a newspaper, which was a primary driver of their business, has an inventory which, you know, basically is zero. And if you called it an inventory, well, it gets sold every day and whatever isn't, and they know how much to produce because they've been producing it for a long time. But as they bought new companies, you can imagine that the flooring company, for example, or the framing company, for example, need inventories that are going to be on the books for some period of time. It's just a cost of doing business. It's not outrageous. It's less than 5%. So I'm not at all upset about it. I'm simply making conversation. The other thing is that none of this company's businesses require R&D. So we look at the four taxes for this business and we say, you know, inventory is not bad, but not great. It's going the wrong direction, but it's okay. There's no R&D cost. They're doing a great job of controlling general sales and administrative. And the plants and equipment, generally speaking, has been very good, although COVID was a bad year. So all of a sudden you say, well, this company seems to, even though they've got a bunch of businesses that are diverse in the way they run, in the aggregate, it seems to be doing a really good job, which is, again, one of the reasons why I like this company, even though it's a conglomerate. The fifth tax that I look at is interest payments. I kind of look at it as a self-imposed tax. If you're borrowing a bunch of money, you have to pay interest payments back. If your business is really, really well run or really, really profitable, you'd never need to borrow money, and so there wouldn't be this interest payment. Interest payments are also something that you have to pay in good times and in bad. And so, you can't really scale back interest payments just because you're having a bad time, like you can plants and equipment or inventories. So I look closely at interest payments. The interest payments for this company are not good, and the company was graded appropriately as a result of that. But don't worry about interest payments. We're gonna talk a lot about this company's balance sheet in the next video, and there's more going on here than just the amount of interest payments. So we'll look closely at that, but for now, just assume that I recognize the interest obligations are higher than I would like, but I understand what's going on and I'm okay with it. So again, in summary, this company is a conglomerate. As such, some of the attributes that I would tend to like in a company will be sort of absorbed into the regression of the mean for the entire business. The company is, earnings per share have been gradually growing, but not fast. It's not the end of the world because we bought this company at 7.5 times earnings. The earnings per share, the earnings have been growing gradually, but not fast. The earnings per share have been performing better because the company's bought back some stock. We can talk more about that on wealth creation. A net earnings as a percentage of revenue in the top 25% of companies, which has allowed me to overlook some of the issues with gross margins. And the five taxes are all looking pretty good for the company. So long story short, the operations of the company, even though I only gave it 2.78 out of 4, which is, we'll call it a C+, because I understand what's going on with the company, I'm willing to overlook the C+, because I think it's got a lot of potential and we're buying the company very, very cheap. So that's it for Graham Holdings operations. Thank you very much.